belong. The Waco History Podcast is sponsored by Brotherwell Brewing on Historic Bridge Street in Waco.
Cross the Brazos in Waco, ride hard and I'll make it by dawn. Cross the Brazos in Waco, I'm safe when I reach San Antonio.
So thank y'all for sticking around. This is a live recording of the Waco History Podcast. My name is Stephen Sloan, and I am the host of the Waco History Podcast. And we're recording tonight at the opening of the People Who Made Dr. Pepper exhibit at the Dr. Pepper Museum in downtown Waco. So I've got two guests with me tonight to talk a little bit about the museum and the era in which the bottling room operated. And the first one is Bj Greaves. So Bj, thanks for joining me.
Absolutely.
You can go back and listen. Bj was on a previous episode of the podcast talking about
the Dr. Pepper company when I was a kid.
Well, you did the interview with me talking about that, but Milton Scott.
I do remember that. You're right. In the park.
That's right. We did a recording in the park. But we've had Bj here tonight because Bj, I don't know if you remember when we were reading names earlier, we read names of all those that worked at the Dr. Pepper Museum or those that we could identify. And one name we read that was not in my voice, but BJ's, was William T. Bill Greaves. And so let's start by you telling us who William Greaves was.
Yeah. That was my dad. And he started working for Dr. Pepper in 1941, was absent from the company for 3 years during World War II while he was in the Army. But then when he was discharged from the Army in 45, he came back to the company, worked here in this building until 1977 when he retired.
Mm-hmm. And so I would love to know your first memories of this building, and when you didn't have a job here, but kind of your early memories of coming in this space.
Let me say this first. When I was about 8 years old, I was making these life decisions of what I wanted to be when I grew up, and I had sort of narrowed it down to being a preacher or being an architect. And my mom and dad were in the kitchen of the little house we lived in. Dad was reading the paper at the kitchen table. Mom was at the sink doing something. And I came in and told my mom, I think I would like to be a preacher. And she said, that's really good. That's great. You know, you have to learn Greek. And I was like, wait, what? No. And so I thought, well, okay. I think I'd like to be an architect. And she said, that's great. You realize you have to learn algebra. And I thought, man, this is getting worse by the minute. And I asked her, I said, is there something I can do where I don't have to learn anything? And my dad, sitting at the kitchen table, said, you can work for Dr. Pepper. My first memory of this building, and as far as I know, it's the first time I set foot in this building, and this is going to sound really odd to you, was on Monday, August 22nd, 1955. I was 4 years old, within 3 months of my fifth birthday. My younger sister was born on August 21st, 1955, on a Sunday. And so Dad had taken the Monday off because he needed to babysit me and my older sister while Mom was in the hospital. But I don't know why, but Dad brought me to the building. We came in the front door, and a bunch of the people working here in the office area, including the man who was the manager at the time, whose name I just cannot remember right now, came out. I remember them shaking his hand, patting him on the back. Like I said, I was a little over 4 years old, so I wasn't sure what was going on. But the man who was manager was an older gentleman, and I remember him sort of bending way down and shaking my hand and just introducing himself to me. The other thing I remember about the building, about the office area, was on the wall, it was covered in these plaques that were per capita awards that they had won year after year after year within the company. And the little award was a wooden plaque, but it had a little brass or bronze sculpture of a little baby wearing a Dr. Pepper hat, holding a Dr. Pepper bottle. And they were all the same, but they had dates on them. And I remember asking my dad, what was that? And he explained it to me, although I don't know the four-year-old understands what a per capita award might be, but he did his best. That was the first time I was in the building. Then he was a route salesman at that time. So he drove a route, delivered Dr. Pepper. His routes were out in the country generally throughout Central Texas. He often said that was the best job he ever had because you're just out there by yourself. You're kind of your own boss. You're making, developing relationships on behalf of the company with store owners, grocery store owners, gas station owners, any place that he could sell Dr. Pepper. And then he got promoted up through to, I think, assistant sales manager and sales manager. And while he was sales manager, the man, Chester Harris, who was the manager at that time, passed away. And then Dad was promoted into that role where he served until he retired. But we would come up on Sunday afternoon, he and I, and the sales room was this room right to our right here. And every Monday morning, very early, all the route salesmen would meet, and Dad, as the sales manager, would go over their sales for the week previous, their quotas and projections for what they were expected to do on their routes for the coming week, and then they would leave, get their trucks, and go. There's a chalkboard high up on the wall in that room that's kind of pre-lined and pre-printed with different information, but all the handwritten information in that chalkboard is Dad's handwriting. The names of the individual route salesmen, they're still there, and some of the numbers of what they were expected to do. So while he was doing that, and the salesman, the route salesman sat in these little desk, like you sit in a school with the desk and the arm, while he would do that, I would sit there and draw. And he would give me these receipt books that I could draw on. They were pre-printed. They had a white copy, a yellow copy, maybe a pink copy, and some carbon paper in between. And then the route salesman would fill out the ticket when he delivered the Dr. Pepper to wherever it was going. And one of the tickets would go to the customer, and the other two would come back to the office. And but the backside of those sheets were blank. And the primo sheets in the ticket book were the white ones. So I would draw pictures on the back of the white ones. In fact, my wife found the other day a picture I'd drawn for my grandmother at Christmas, apparently. It was Santa Claus and a sleigh and whatever. But I would draw until I got bored. And then I would go play in the building. And Dad always said, you can go, it's okay. Don't go up on the third floor. I don't really know why I wasn't allowed to go on the third floor, except I was probably out of earshot if he was going to holler at me for something. And he said, don't turn anything on, don't touch anything. So I would leave and go up the stairs to the second floor, and you can't imagine what a temptation it was to not turn on something, not touch something, and not go up on the third floor. So I would just play and run around. Going up the steps right out here as you come in the front door, going up the little wooden steps, there was a hole in one of the risers about halfway up the flight of steps that I convinced myself was a mouse hole. It could have been just a knot that came out of the wood at some point, but I convinced myself it was a mouse hole. So when I would go up the stairs or down the stairs, when I got to that step, I would jump across for fear that the mouse would come out and get me. When we restored, and that's something, I got involved in this building as an adult, as the architect for all of the restoration, renovations, pretty much everything that was done to turn it into a museum. So when I got involved as the architect for this building in 1989, that riser with the hole in it was still there. And so as we were restoring, and the stair was in pretty bad shape. So as we were restoring, and the contractor was rebuilding the stairway, I had mixed emotions about whether or not I should leave that with the hole in it because it was personal history to me, or whether we should go ahead and return it to its original appearance. And we went ahead and returned it to its original appearance, as we were trying to do with all the rest of the building. And it's one of the real regrets in life that I have that we didn't keep that mouse hole just because of all the memories it meant to me. But I would play in the building. The railroad track on Mary Street had a siding that came right beside the building. And so on Sunday afternoons, there would be a train that would go back and forth up and down the track, taking boxcars up the way to different companies and retrieving empty boxes or whatever and bringing them back. And so I was into trains like any kid would be. So when a train would come by, I would climb up on a chair, because in that room, the windows are half moon shaped, but they're high. I'd climb up on a chair so I could look out the window and watch the train slowly come by, going each direction. I just had all kinds of neat memories of being in this building as a kid. And another thing that I noticed was there's a great deal of camaraderie among the employees. And not really, I mean, they all seem to be friends. And I've worked enough in my career to know that's not always the case, but it seemed to be the case here. And the one thing, thinking back on it, that I sort of attribute that to, the majority of these men were all about the same age. So they were all, at the time that I met them, most of them, if not all of them, were veterans of World War II or the Korean War. And as veterans, they had within their units developed a strong bond with their fellow soldiers. The way that you depend on somebody for your own livelihood, your life, your safety. And I think that carried over into that generation of men and the way they worked with one another as they got into their, whatever their chosen profession. It was very common then, and unfortunately very uncommon now, for somebody to start in a job, in a profession, and stay there for their whole career at the same place. And a lot of these men did. I grew up and got to relate to them as more as an older child, as an older adolescent, as an adult, the ones that were still here. And you don't really see that nowadays. But you just had a sense of family when you were here among the guys that worked here.
I want to thank BJ for just giving us an idea of what it was like. I mean, his from four to throughout your professional career has been attached to this building. So I appreciate you coming
Absolutely.
And sharing some of that with us. So let's thank BJ. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. So I'm going to invite my second guest over.
Well, there you go.
All right, there we go. Mr. Griggs, if you'll come join me over here. So my second guest tonight, again, we are here for the people who made Dr. Pepper, the opening of the new exhibit at the Dr. Pepper Museum. And this is Mr. Harvey Griggs. We are fortunate to have him with us tonight. And Mr. Griggs, I interviewed about 18 months ago. He did not, he's had some Dr. Pepper. You drank a Dr. Pepper. He has never worked at Dr. Pepper.
Right.
But he's here to help us understand kind of working at an industrial place during this period where Dr. Pepper was operating. Mr. Griggs is from West.
Right.
Yeah, eight kids in the Griggs family, right? Eight kids?
Yeah.
Eight kids in the Griggs family. And so if you would start and tell us about your first job in Waco. There's a lot of stories you can tell, but let's start with working in Waco and your first job you had.
Okay.
Yeah.
The first job I had here in Waco was at the oil mill.
Uh-huh.
Cottonseed
oil mill.
Yeah.
You know it as the silos, but it's the cottonseed oil
cotton
mill.
It's cottonseed, right. Yeah. In fact, when they build the silos, and I think my daughter, somebody asked me, she said, you want to go down to Magnolia? I said, no, I know every place. been all over that silo. Ain't nothing I want to see. But anyway, that was the first job, you know, working in the seed room.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and down there, you know, it just blacks. Only white was in the office,
uh-huh.
You know, two driving trucks. But anyway, and it was a seasonal job. You know, so come around Christmas time or the first of the year, cotton rolls be over with, you know, did everything. So they would shut the oil mill down. And they would get it prepared. Some of them would stay there and work and get it prepared ready for the next year. So come January, they saying, okay, says, we're going to be shutting down, you know, within a, and so I got to find me another job.
Yeah.
So I went out to the glass plant. They were not hiring. You know, come back. So went out to the glass plant. So we're not hiring. So, and I went out and filled out another application, about three or four applications. And finally, they called me. Said, "Come out for an interview." Said, okay. Went out and stayed out there all day with the interview. They said, "Well, you can come to work tonight." 11 o'clock. You know, never had a job working at night. You know? So I went out and they told me, the first thing they told me is, okay, you get two breaks and a lunch. 10 minutes, two 10 minute break, one 30 minute break. Not 10 and a half, not 11. But 10 minutes, okay? So they had a cafeteria, I mean, full cafeteria. The way it was designed, you know, the counter, you know. Then they had a little area in there, that's where the blacks were supposed to be,
so
1965.
Kind of a main area, and then there was kind of a room at the back.
Right, a little, something like this here, but it probably wasn't that big, about two or three tables in there, you know. So we coming from the warehouse up there, by the time we get there and get where we want, we had to turn around and come back because we got to be back at the truck at 10 minutes. So I can't exactly tell you how many steps, how many, what it was from the warehouse to the, but anyway, 9.5 minutes we was back at the truck. Because we just getting started. Now, like this gentleman, I'm gonna tell you something that happened to me when I started there. I started in January the 25th. That's winter time. But it's mostly like today, kind of hot and warm.
Uh-huh.
So that night, I went to work with a coat just about this size. 2:30, it's snowing. I mean, not, it's snowing.
Uh-huh.
So now I'm there about 3 weeks now. So I'm sitting there, they're gonna come and tell us to go home in a few minutes, you know, all this snow and everything. I'm cold, don't have a jacket to put on. So I asked one of the fellas who was already there, I said, when are they gonna come and tell us to go home? He looked at me and laughed. He said, this is 24/7, you know, we don't share that.
Yeah,
you
know? Don't close.
Man, what have I gotten in myself into? You know, so getting back to the port, you know, it was only in the warehouses where the majority was, all the blacks were, you know. They wasn't up in the front. They wasn't on the bottle line. They wasn't on the mold shop. It was all in the warehouse.
Uh-huh. You know.
So when we would, like I said, go to the restaurant up at a cafe. We had to be back 30 minutes. We had to be back, you know. But while we back working, they're still in the office.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is where it was in 1965. Mm-hmm. You know. So bouncing back, before then, you said up there, the sit down has already happened.
Uh-huh.
After the sit down, I comes up with an attitude, So I took my attitude into the glass plant with me.
So he's talking about, so when I interviewed Mr. Griggs, we were talking about sit-ins in Waco where they were sitting in and integrating lunch counters and other space.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, so, but me, now I'm got an attitude.
Yeah.
See. Because I'm looking on the TV, you know, and I'm seeing all this there, you know, so I get an attitude.
Yeah.
So I get out to the glass plant. It's a whole different world now, you know. Because in the glass plant, in the warehouse, and then the rest of it, you know, we still segregated.
Uh-huh.
You know. Now I'm talking, you know, so one of those men said, look, young man, said, you don't know. So you better settle down, you know. He said, things is not what it is, and not what you think it is,
mm-hmm.
you know. So, I don't know if one of the questions you got to ask me, what you could ask me, but 35, 39 and a half years later, I settled down. Because I had a family.
Yeah.
And when you got a family and trying to make a living for them, you take a whole lot.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So what are you saying? I took a whole lot in those almost 40 years, but I took care of my family, you know.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
When you on the outside looking in, it looks different. Yeah. But when you in the middle, you know, it's a different story.
Yeah.
Now, to wind it back down, you know, not to let you ask me questions and everything, I don't regret any of it,
uh-huh.
you know. I enjoyed, I made a good living for the family and everything, and I learned how to deal with peoples, not on a black and white issue,
yeah.
but on a people
yeah.
issue.
Yeah.
You know, you said questions, you know, would anybody got into questions, you know, but that's my story of the glass plant.
Yeah.
Come to Dr. Pepper. I loaded a mini bottles for Dr. Pepper.
So now, you know? Now you told me when you started the glass plant in 65, the lunchroom was segregated.
Right.
But then tell me what happened when it integrated, when it wasn't segregated anymore.
When we would go up there, you know, you could sit anywhere you want to. I'm not going to call the lady's name, you know, but anyway, she was one of the cooks out there and the server. So we got our plate and we went sit in the middle. So we started laughing and she couldn't take that. Y'all need to get over in that corner where y'all belongs. You know? So we all looked. You know, where we belong,
mm-hmm.
you know. And mindset, that's the way she thought.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
But during then, I think we handled it well. You know, we just looked at her, you know, we kept going. But it took a while for them to get used to the blacks being anywhere. It took a while for them to even have blacks put in for jobs in different departments
mm-hmm.
because it was only, blacks was only set up for, why in the warehouse, why? It was no doors, so it was hot.
Yep.
In the summertime,
and cold.
Cold in the winter.
Yeah.
You know. So when I got there, they had two blacks driving tow motors. You know.
Uh-huh.
And the rest, you know.
Rest doing more manual work.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Manually work, you know. Mm-hmm. They had showers set up. They had one big, excuse me. It was one big unit, you know, and on the back, on one side was the shower for the white, and on the other side was the shower for the black. They couldn't even shower in the same,
mm-hmm.
you know, couldn't even go to the same bathroom,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
So what, you know, when I started, you got used to it because it took from 65, I think it was 67 to 68 when it actually, you know, integrated.
Mm-hmm.
So there was 3 years.
Yeah.
But then they had men before me that's been there 15, 20, 30 years that put through, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so as far as the integrated and segregated, you know, it took a while to get used to it.
Yeah.
I can remember when they had the first black females out there, they had three of them. And they told us in the warehouse, when you get up there, they got some colored women working up there now. Don't you all talk to them. So when I get up to the cafeteria, one of those three colored women was my sister-in-law. So now,
yeah.
I said, now he crazy if he think I'm not gonna talk to my sister-in-law. You know,
yeah.
So, but what they went through as an icebreaker for the females to be up there,
yeah.
You know, I just imagine it was a whole lot more difficult for them than it was for, because at least back there in the warehouse, we did have a few,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So in a way, we got along, in a way we didn't.
Yeah.
You know, it was just a line, you know, you get up close to that line as long as you don't cross over. Mm-hmm. You know, and that was part of life during then. Mm-hmm. You know, you can get up to the line, but don't cross it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So how many years did you work at the glass plant?
39 and a half.
39 and a half years.
They said, why don't you stay here another 6 months and get in 40 years? 39 is too long.
You already stayed 6 months longer than you should have.
And I didn't notice, you know, one of them is here to blast. He can kind of go along with what I'm saying, too, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I made a good living. I don't regret anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what I went through was a learning lesson, you know. Integration, you know, segregation, you know, and all, but all that's part of life.
Yeah.
You know.
When do you feel like in working in the space you worked that you were getting equal opportunities? Like, when do you feel like that came along, or do you ever feel like there was a time where?
To be truthful, I guess I can say when I became the president of the credit union out there.
Yeah. And when was that?
That was, oh man.
Sorry.
1990s.
Okay.
I served as the president for 17 years.
Okay.
And I guess the reason why I'm saying then is because it seemed like I was more in control,
yeah,
than being controlled.
Yes.
You know.
Yeah.
I was able to tell and to manage people's, you know.
Yeah.
And then, you know, sometime when they thought things wasn't going like they wanted in the credit union, then they had come to me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it made me feel like I was, like I say, in control.
Yeah.
And I was.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I went into the maintenance department. I had a practically a department that I was the only maintenance guy down there,
mm-hmm,
you know. We was on call 24/7, you know, so if anything went wrong, then I had to be the...
Yeah, you were the guy that called.
That was it.
Yeah.
So I felt kind of in control down there, but like I said, when I became the president of the credit union, it really just, you know, not 99 anymore.
Yeah.
99.9. I was the man. You know?
Well, Mr. Griggs, oh, that's all right. Well, Mr. Griggs, I appreciate you sharing some with us, because and you hadn't told me that story before about the credit union. So I appreciate you telling me that.
Well, you didn't ask me.
Yeah, I didn't ask you, you would have told me, right? Well, let's thank Mr. Griggs for sharing with us tonight.
Thank you.
Don't get away without this. All right, thank y'all so much for coming out for the live podcast recording and exhibit opening. There's probably food left somewhere, so.
Thanks for listening to the Waco History Podcast. Like what you heard? Subscribe, rate, and review our show on iTunes so we can reach more listeners. You can find show notes and info on every episode at wacohistorypodcast.com and more info on Waco's past at wacohistory.org. Our theme music, used with permission, is Cross the Brazos at Waco, performed by the late Billy Walker. For more info on Billy's music, go to billywalker.com. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time. This has been a Rogue Media Network production.